just worship him. Oh Lord, just worship him, yeah. Cause you're you, I ain't even gotta have a reason. I worship you. 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 I worship you.
Hallelujah. Everything I have, everything I am, in this moment, Father, I declare, it's all about you. I just want to please your heart. I just want to worship you. Yeah. I just want to see your face. Yeah. I just want to love on you. Yeah. Say, I just want.
I just want to please your heart.
I just want to worship.
I just want to worship you.
All over this room declare, I just want to see your face.
I just want to see your face.
Oh Lord, I just want to love on you.
I just want to love on you.
Come on, make this the confession of your heart today. I just want to please your heart, oh God. Anybody chasing after him today? I just want to worship.
I just want to worship you.
Yeah. I just want to see.
I just want to see your face.
Yeah. I just want to love on you.
I just want to.
Can you raise this up with all the passion inside of you? Say, I just want to please your heart. Room, declare your love for him. I just want to worship.
I just want to worship you.
Yeah, I just want to see your face.
I just want to see your face.
Lord, let me get in your face today. I just want to love on you.
I just want to love on you.
Yeah, yeah. I just want to please your heart. Somebody declare it in this atmosphere. I just want to worship. That's why my hands are lifted. That's why my voice is raised. I just want to see your face. Somebody say, I just want to love. Somebody just open up your mouth and begin to bless the name of the Lord today. Somebody declare your affection for your Father. Somebody declare your adoration for your Savior. Yeah. You know, I declare this. It's all about you. It's all about you. It's all about you. in this house. Declare. Say, it's all about you. Raise it up, say, it's all.
It's all about you.
Of the real worshipers, Father, hear the voices of your true worshipers.
I just want to love on you.
One more time. Nothing but voices say, I just want to please your heart. Yes, Lord. I just want to worship you. I just want to see your face.
And we get on one accord. Your presence fills the temple. Everything we need and more. Your manifest.
Well, well, well. So let me tell you, and you know your pastor's crazy, and I admit that wholeheartedly. I woke up on Thursday morning, like around 2:30, and God began to minister to my heart about the message for today. So around 4 o'clock, all I kept hearing was worth, because it ties into the message today. And I love that song, by the way. And Minister Anthony Brown, just his voice is so powerful. And I saw someone dancing to that song. So I did like any other pastor would do at 4 o'clock in the morning. I emailed like 5 people, literally, expecting them to be up. Sometimes they're actually up, by the way, which is hilarious. And they respond back. We have these whole conversations overnight. So anyway, I said, my heart is that someone would dance. I know that we have the hymn choir, and we have beautiful psalmists who could, you know, belt that out. But what was in my head, in my heart, is a dance routine. And I said, let's call out to people. Now, people have jobs and responsibilities, you know, so I'm very sensitive to that. And so as we were talking to different people, Vashti Clark came to my mind. And I said, she can dance, Lord. And so I called her. And I said, and she, first of all, she thought she was in trouble, number one. I said, you're not in trouble, child. This time. Yeah, very good, mother. No, not this time. Other times, yes, but not this time. And I said, and I hate when people ask me leading questions, so I can't stand it, but I did it this time. I said, you can dance, can't you? And she said, well, you know what's interesting? For years at my father's church, I was a part of the liturgical dance team. I said, you know what, God, you are real. So I said, I'd like for you to dance this Sunday. That was Thursday morning. And she said, I got to call you back. She legit said that. And if you know her, she's like, I got to call you back. So she said, I'm going to call you back tonight. I got a text that night around 10 o'clock. I need more time. I'm going to call you back tomorrow. And so I sent a text to her to say, hey, what are we going to do? And she didn't know I had, you know, plan B, C, and D. But honestly, in my mind, there was no plan B. It was plan A. And so she said, she FaceTimed me. She loves to FaceTime. So she FaceTimes me. She says, look, I was going to say no. And I said, well, okay. She said, but God spoke to my heart. And he said to her, and I'm paraphrasing, he said to her, it's not about skill, it's about will. And I so appreciated that because she could have done that because her pastor asked her to do that. But I didn't want, I don't want any of you all to do anything that I ask you to do. She went to her Heavenly Father. Her Heavenly Father said, Vashti, it's not about skill, it's about will. She hadn't danced in 10 years. She now has 2 beautiful babies. She's married. She got a big job and all kinds of responsibilities. But she found the time because she had the will in addition to the skill. And I wondered, and I asked myself this question, if my authority called me up with less than 3 days to do something that I normally don't do, would I do it? And so it caught me. And what's funny is, she didn't know this, I knew that she was going to say yes. She said, no, I didn't. Yes, I did. We're more righteous than we believe, church. That's what come up in the message. We're holier than what we believe. We want to say yes when God calls us. I know our flesh tells us that we're not. But here's an example how all of us can push past our flesh and do what the Lord said to do, not what your pastor says to do. And I was so blessed by that. And it just warmed my heart. And it's a lesson for all of us. Now she can go back to being mommy and handle that child back there. One is grown and she's fine. But the other one, handle her. But anyway, let's go hear from a holy and righteous God this morning. And let's see who says yes today. Because you don't say yes once. See, our flesh says no all the time. So we have to say yes all the time. Let's go to God in prayer. Father, I thank you for your Son, Jesus Christ, who reminded us they were worthy of your love. We didn't have to do anything to earn it, to achieve it, to accomplish anything of it. All we had to do was ask of it. Matter of fact, you gave it to us before we asked for it. That's truly a gift, Father. And we thank you that that gift will be and has been on display this entire service, whether it be through prayer, whether it be words of encouragement, whether it be through the song, the sang or sung word, or whether it be through the danced presentation. We thank you, Father, that your love has been on display all throughout this service. And Father, now people have come to hear from your love through the preached word. So I'm going to decrease and allow your spirit to rise bold in me to teach and to preach what's on your heart and what's on your mind. And Father, we'll be so careful to give your name the praise, the glory, and the honor that it so richly deserves. It's in Jesus Christ's name we do pray and give thanks. Amen. With our Bibles turned to Ephesians chapter number 5, we want to continue in our teaching series entitled, Walk Circumspectly. Walk circumspectly. And let's read here for a bit, starting at chapter 5 of the book of Ephesians, verse 1. Be ye therefore followers of God as dear children, and walk in love, as Christ also loved us. See, church, we can't dance in love until we walk in love. We can't sing in love until we walk in love. We can't usher in love until we walk in love. We can't preach in love until we walk in love. And walk in love as Christ also have loved us and have given himself for us an offering and a sacrifice to God for a sweet-smelling savor. Go over to verse 15. See then that ye walk circumspectly, not as fools, but as wise. Redeeming the time, because the days are evil. Church, here's a guiding statement for this series. We must walk carefully. Walk carefully. In other words, church, we have to be mindful of every step we take. The reason why some of us are misstepping is we're not careful of every step that we take. It's okay to take your time. You know, when you see people speeding by you on the road, they rushing to go nowhere. I've learned as I've gotten older, it's okay to be organized enough to leave early, to safely arrive, to take my time. I notice I drive slower now, and I'm okay with being in the right lane. You know, maybe there was a time in my life where I was a left lane, brother. But I'm okay with taking my time. We used to take family trips. I used to hate to stop. I used to hate road trips when I can't stand driving long trips anyway. And I would hate to stop. So if we're going to Atlanta, we leaving at 2 in the morning, and we getting there by 10, which is what we did that one time. Yeah, we did. Yeah, we got there in just over 8 hours for a 10-hour trip. But anyway, don't worry about that. Don't worry about that. Yeah. But now, maybe because of my bladder too, I got an old bladder, I don't mind stopping. Stop and get something to eat. You know, you go to Cracker Barrel and I walk through all the little side, the store. I don't buy anything. I go, oh, look at that. That's real nice. That look real nice in our kitchen. I ain't going to buy it. And then we, you know, get a little further and, oh, you know what? Let's go to Wawa because I love Wawa. But what I've learned in life, it's okay to slow down and to pay attention to every step we take. Because I've said, church, we're always one step away from unrighteousness. Just one step. Listen to the intent, purpose, and goal differently today. To walk circumspectly, we must always know what time it is. There shouldn't be any part in our life that we don't know what time, state, or season that we're in. I don't care if you're 2 or 81. You have to know what season you're in. And I think sometimes the reason why we falter is we're older trying to live in a season that's been passed. You know, for our older folk over 45, we shouldn't dress like we're 22. Now, some things are appropriate for an age. You know, that's fine. That's cute on them. But on us, we look silly. Oh, somebody's going to be mad at me with this. The cut-up jeans, that's for the young set. Because when we were growing up, if you had holes in your jeans, oh, your mom and daddy didn't work. Y'all were poor. We talked bad about you for having holes in your jeans. Now, it looks great on the young people, but it's interesting when I see an older person wearing them, they look so out of place. You know, the rip is up from here to here, like your whole leg is hanging out. It's interesting, when we're out of place, it shows. That means we don't know what season it is. For men, we can't dress like the young kids are dressing. For our life givers, I know it's hard to find things in the store to wear that fits us and looks good on us. But some of us, that time has passed. Things that were up are now down. Don't accentuate things that used to be up that are now down. For those who know, they know. I don't want to get in trouble up here. To walk circumspectly, we must be reminded that the days are evil, church. You know, I'm a news junkie, and I admit that. But I'm getting tired of watching the news. Here's what's interesting. And I was in media for 33 years, and it's interesting how it happens now. They'll promote, before the news starts, somebody died here, somebody died here, somebody died here, right? And then the first one they lead with, oh, let's talk about the weather. A life being lost is not as important as the weather now. Isn't that a shame? All these folks died that they promote, but then before we get to all that tragedy, let's talk about the weather. It's cloudy and rainy outside. Hey, how about this? It rained yesterday here in the DMV. That's not news. Somebody losing their life on the street at 12 midnight coming out of a club on 8th Street last night, that's news. Three people's families are hurting because one person died and two folks in the hospital. So three different families are hurting right now. That's news. But even that is depressing. But church, the days are evil. And also to walk circumspectly, we must be wise. Next week, we're going to learn about how to receive wisdom. But church, we must be wise. In our first week, we asked the question, how to walk circumspectly? And I said, we must walk exactly, diligently, and perfectly. To walk circumspectly, bless you, we must walk exactly, diligently, and perfectly. Then last week, church, I asked the question, how do fools walk? Because it says here, see then that you walk circumspectly, not as fools, but as wise. And you know your pastor's not going to skip over that. Apostle Paul said here, don't walk as a fool. Well, if I'm out here, I want to know, how do fools walk? And I said that fools walk inexactly, inactively, and imperfectly, the direct opposite of how you walk circumspectly. And we define, not we, the word of God defined a fool as silly, stupid, and vile. And to my parents who have children here, please tell them that that word is not an appropriate word to use, but your pastor is speaking out of the word of God. But yeah, a fool is defined as someone who's silly, stupid, and vile. And then I gave us a test. And I asked a question for the test, am I a fool? And we went up and down the book of Proverbs to 20 different scriptures to identify whether or not we're a fool. So for those of you all who were absent from class last week, go to our YouTube channel, watch the service, take the test. Here's the good news. It's an open book test. And ask yourself after you've taken that test, am I a fool? I heard from folks face-to-face, email, phone call and text all throughout this week. Like, Pastor, I'm sorry, I'm a fool. They just went in. People don't even go to the church. We were going to a homegoing service on Friday. Somebody walked up to me at the parent church. Don't even go here. Oh, my God, you taught on how to be a fool. I need some work to do, Pastor. I said, well, First of all, I ain't your pastor. You go deal with that on your own. And I was like, y'all are crazy out here. So you want to subtitle today's message, Who Stops and Prevents Us from Walking Circumspectly? Who stops and prevents us from walking circumspectly? And I'm going to say it differently, church. The fool in us is what stops us and prevents us from walking circumspectly. And you know, we've been here since April looking at who prevents and stops us from walking, depending on what that walking is. In this case, it's walking circumspectly. But I want to remind us of who us is. Our beliefs, our attitudes, and our thoughts, our BATs, our BATs. We said our beliefs are those things that are accepted as true, but they're not. They're beliefs. They're things that we believe as true, and they are not true. Absolutely not true. Then we have our attitude. Those are our feelings towards someone or something. This is how we feel about something or someone. We don't have any evidence of why we feel the way we feel. You know, you ever dislike somebody and you know why you don't dislike them? They've done nothing to you, nothing wrong. There are people that you don't even know. You go, I don't like him. Why not? I don't know. That's the way he comes in. He act all, really? You know, they're TV characters, actors we don't like because they play a villain. You know, that's not real, right? I can't stand him. He's probably nasty in his home. Like, oh my Lord, he's just playing a character. Then we have our thoughts. Now, our thoughts are nothing more than a tool designed to manipulate our actions. See, if we thought about what we think about, we wouldn't misstep. Before we made a move, let me think about what I'm thinking about. You know, what I'm thinking about isn't healthy for me, so let me stand and be still. The reason why we sin is we ignore our thoughts and keep it on moving. See, church, our beliefs, our attitudes, and our thoughts are a tool designed, as I said, to manipulate our actions, right? But our beliefs, our attitudes, and our thoughts prevent and stop us from walking exactly, diligently, and perfectly, church. So we know that we stop us and prevent us from walking circumspectly, right? But here's what's interesting. Way too many of us are allowing or have allowed others' beliefs, attitudes, and thoughts to determine our value. Way too many of us are allowing or have allowed others' beliefs, attitudes, and thoughts to determine our value, our worth, which in turn prevents us from walking circumspectly, which in turn stops us from walking circumspectly. And as I said just a minute ago, church, you know a definition of value? Something or someone of worth. You know, in our society, typically assigned to a dollar figure. Our value, our worth. We have given our worth, our value, over someone else's beliefs, attitudes, and thoughts about us. I got permission from this person to share this story. After service last week, I was talking to someone at some point, him or her, and they shared with me how back in the first grade, they were playing Duck, Duck, Goose. Now, that's funny. I hadn't heard that since the first grade. And for those who don't know, because y'all young kids, you know, y'all don't play these kind of games anymore. You would sit in a circle, and someone would be the chaser, and someone would be the chasee. So if you can imagine 10 people sitting in a circle, so I would go around and go duck, 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 and I love playing Duck, Duck, Goose, by the way, duck, duck, and I would be the one who would go around like 3 times, keep going duck, duck. And then when you say goose, the person who you tap on the head or the shoulder would have to chase you. If they caught you, you had to sit in the middle of the circle until the next person got caught. Well, this person in the first grade was playing duck, duck, goose, and evidently they were slow and got caught and had to sit in the center. Well, someone yells out a very damaging thing about their complexion and talks about how dark they are. And to this day, this person still is struggling with that because of what somebody said to them in the first grade. Now, I promise you, they're not in the second grade now. They've lived a little bit. See, church, we allow other people's beliefs, attitudes, and thoughts to determine our value and our worth. And I know that sticks and stones may break our bones, but words will never hurt us. And what they were speaking of was, you know, a physical hurt. But words cut to the heart. And it's hard to heal an internal wound. You know, if you ever have surgery, it's one thing to cut your hand and get a Band-Aid, and a couple of days is healed. But to have open heart surgery, all those organs, all those veins, all those arteries kind of coming together to have to work together to be healed together, that's a lot. Here's what I want everybody to hear. God set, past tense, our value. God set, past tense, our worth. And I purposely pause right there because there are too many of us who still believe what someone said when they were 12 years old about your complexion, about you being ugly. And it took me 10 years from 12 to 22, 21 years old to get over that. The church, God set our value. And I thought of this example over a month ago, and I didn't know how I was going to use it, but I know God was going to get me to use it. And media team, you might have to make a close-up of this. I got a gift from my wife, Father's Day, birthday, I forget. We've been together a long time. We don't know when the gifts come out anymore. This is a frame my wife bought me. And it has two IDs in it. The top one is my father's driver's license, and then my mother's student ID at Howard University. Now, outside of my wedding ring, this is the most precious gift I've ever received in my life. Now, we have a lot of things, and we've had a lot of things, but let me be clear. The frame that my wife put this in, if it costs a dollar, she paid too much for it. And my wife don't like spending a whole lot of money. So I promise you, she didn't go to Tiffany's where I would have gone to get a frame, because I'm stupid. I'm a fool. But I'd have gone to Tiffany's and bought this. She got this from the dollar store. But this is the most precious gift. And I keep this by my nightstand. Because what it reminds me of is I'm an educated servant. My mother was all about education. She went to the Juilliard School of Music to study opera, and then she went to Howard for undergrad studies. And my father worked for the Department of Transportation and was a cab driver. And he was a servant of servants. And just this picture reminds me, Michael, that you're an educated servant. The reason why I'm bringing this up, I've established a value of this. So you may say, oh, Pastor, that's not worth anything. But to me, outside of my wedding ring, as far as stuff in our house, this is the second most valuable thing that I own. No one can tell me differently about the value of this. You can argue it. You can do whatever you want. But this, for me, is the most precious thing outside of my wedding band that I own. That's how God feels about us. He determined, he set the value, he set the worth for us. So don't let anybody tell you what your worth, what your value is. You might just be a simple frame that needs to be cleaned, Michael. It's fine. But that by itself is precious to the Lord. Don't let anybody tell you differently about yourself. Because all we are is kind of a dirty frame, small in stature, you know, laying up on somebody's nightstand. But it has great value. But here's the question of the day. Okay. She's okay. She's with grandmommy. That's good. Good lesson. Have your children with you in church. So when they find themselves in a situation, you're there to handle it. But here's the question of the day. How valuable are we to God? How valuable are we to God? Church, we're so valuable to God. He gave us dominion, deliverance, and direction. We are so valuable to God that He gave us dominion, deliverance, and direction. And let's look at them one at a time. So you can write at the top, God gave us, for those who are taking notes. God gave us, point number one, dominion. Not dominance, but dominion. Go with me over to Genesis chapter number one. And I know for homework, I had started at verse 27, but I'm going to start reading at verse 26. Just because. I read it a couple of weeks ago. See, I had to get out of my own beliefs, attitudes, and thoughts. I read this a couple of weeks ago. I said, well, God, I don't want to read that again. He said, well, I'm God. I'm going to tell you what to read. So I'm going to read verse 26, starting there, of chapter 1 of the book of Genesis. And the word of God says here, and God said, let us make man in our image, after our likeness. And let them have dominion, not dominance, but dominion over the fish of the sea, over the fowl of the air, over the cattle, and over all the earth, over every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God created he him. Male and female created he them. Look at verse 28. And God blessed them, and God said unto them, be fruitful and multiply. I love this. And replenish the earth and subdue it and have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the fowl of the air, over every living thing that moveth upon the earth. Church, when we talk about what God gave us and gave us dominion, listen to this. God instructed us to replenish the earth. That's your letter A if you want to do letter A. God instructed us to replenish the earth. When I look up that word replenish, it means to fill or be full. No lack. So whatever we take from the earth, give it back. But as you can see, we've done a horrible job. We've done a great job of taking. We've done a horrible job of giving it back. The earth, because of man's sin, is no longer an endless supply of blessedness. We're running out of resources. I know some of us don't believe in climate, you know, change and all that, but when you see oceans or lakes that are now rivers and, you know, polar ice caps that are now melting, something's going on. But God instructed us to replenish the earth. There was supposed to be no lack at all in the earth. No lack. Here's your letter B. God instructed us to subdue the earth. To subdue it. In other words, place it under our control. That's what it means to subdue, to place under our control. In letter C, church, God instructed us to manage the earth. Management lets us know that we don't own it. We're managers of it. But we're to care for it as though it was ours. That's what God said. He said, I'm going to give you everything that I created by speaking it into existence. All I want you to do, I want you to dress and keep what I have given you. I want you to replenish it. I want you to subdue it. And church, I want you to manage it. So while I'm still here in heaven, I want you to take care of what's down here on earth. See, if God didn't see value in us, he wouldn't give us the works of his hands. He spoke these things into existence and said, you know what? I stood back on the seventh day and said, I'm going to rest. I'm going to have a time of uninterrupted fellowship, with what I created. And then after that, hey, man, in the species form that I created, I'm going to form you, create you, make you out of the dust that already exists here on the earth. After I've created you, made you, and formed you, just dress and keep all of this. That's how much value God has placed inside of us. Because let's be honest, if there's something that's valuable to you, you don't just give it to everybody. So after he created the earth, he gave it to us. He says, okay, yeah, I've done it. Here, man, it's yours. So that's great value. But not only did God give us dominion, church, he gave us deliverance. Go with me over to 2 Corinthians chapter number 8. 2 Corinthians chapter number 8. In the first part of 2 Corinthians chapter 8, Apostle Paul, he's writing a letter to the church at Corinth about the Macedonian ministry, the church of Philippi, where that was located, and was saying how they are abounded in their giving. And he would use the Macedonian region and the church of Philippi as an example of how to love, how to give, how to love God, how to hate sin, and how to love to give specifically. And, you know, the church of Corinth has some issues, which is why they have two books. let me write you another letter. But he said to them, model after the church of Macedonia. They are wonderful in how they give. And I want to drop down to verse number 7. Look what it says here. This is 2 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 7. Therefore, as ye abound in everything, in faith, in utterance, in knowledge, and in all diligence. How about that? In your love to us. See that ye abound in this grace also. Look at verse 8. I speak not by commandment, but by occasion of the forwardness of others to prove the sincerity of your love. Sister Clark, I wasn't calling you to command you to do something, but I was speaking out of an occasion because I knew the hearts of the people would receive your gift. And it says here, and to prove the sincerity of their love, look at verse number 9. For ye know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for your sakes he became poor, that through his poverty might be rich. Can you imagine? Jesus was rich. He became poor so that through his poverty, we could become rich. Woo! Church, God gave us deliverance. Listen to this. Again, A, B's, and C's, however you want to put them down, that's fine. Letter A, Jesus delivered us from poverty. Now, Pastor, you taught back on Wednesday, some Wednesdays ago, in the book of Matthew, chapter 5, where Jesus says the poor will always be with us. So wait a minute. How can the two coexist? See, the poverty I'm talking about, is he delivered us from the poverty of death, hell, and eternal damnation. See, I'd rather be poor in money and rich in spirit versus rich in money and poor in spirit. Because the fans you all fanning right now won't do you any good in hell. Jesus delivered us from poverty. Another way of saying this from a letter B standpoint, Jesus rescued us from hell. And I know sometimes we get kind of cute with that. No, he literally rescued us from hell. And I know, even though it's in the Word of God, you don't like it when I say it this way, but Jesus went to hell so we didn't have to go. You mean to tell me my Lord and Savior went to hell? Yes, he did. If we kept reading over in Ephesians chapter 4, the Word of God says, he that ascended, descended first to get those who were laying wait for the promise to come. And what did he do, Sister Brown? He led captivity captive. See, I'm going to go back to being young. I know God visited me when I was 8. And I can't get all the details in my head, but I had that children's Bible, the really big one that had all the pictures in it and what have you. And I remember this so vividly at the age of 8 that it showed a picture of Jesus, not who it says in the Word, but just who the writer thought was Jesus. Leave it there. And it showed Jesus and this train of people following behind him from the ground, below the ground, up, going into heaven. And now, don't ask me why I was reading Ephesians chapter 4 at the age of 8. I have no idea. But I was a curious child, as mother would say, nosy. And so I just happened to land there that day. And that sticks out into my mind. And so, Sister Brown, that's what I see. I can see Jesus at that moment, before he ascended, he descended first to go grab those who were waiting for him in the upper region of the damned. And then they carried them in this train. And he stopped along the way. And that malefactor who said, Jesus, remember me when you enter into paradise. He said, this day you'll be with me in the kingdom of God. He rescued us from hell. He went to hell so we didn't have to go there. See, children, your parents, us, the older set, we went to hell so you don't have to. We did some things we had no business doing. You don't have to follow suit. You know, all the babies we have in here, they don't have to know sin ever. Ever. And I know we talk like, oh, but, you know, they're going to have to experience something. No, they don't. Smoking is bad for you, and any form of smoking. On the cigarette pack, it says, warning, this may kill you. I wish I had that on the liquor bottle. Maybe I wouldn't have, anyway. So guess what? We don't have to say, oh, no, let them have a little taste. No, because we've tasted and seen how horrible sin is to our lives. But not only did Jesus deliver us from poverty and rescued us from hell, I like this, letter C, because it talks about the fact that he was rich and he became poor so that we could become rich. He came to rescue us. Jesus didn't rescue us from his seat in heaven. God the Father said, you know what? I got to take a third of myself, wrap it in that dirty flesh, and go save men. Jesus is the ultimate lifeguard. See, a lifeguard doesn't save you from drowning by sitting in his or her seat. They get wet. They face the same danger. They're actually running into danger to save us. Now, I'm looking at a firefighter over here. I'm amazed you, my brother, would do that kind of work. That's why I call you my superhero, for many reasons. You know why. But when there's a fire, what do? We call 911. We run out the house. They come and they run into a burning building to rescue us. They're not at the fire station saying, okay, Mike, here's what you want to do. okay, I want you to go get the baking soda. You know, no, they come to our rescue. See, that's how valuable we are. That Jesus says, I can't leave them hopeless and helpless down here. I'll go, Father. I'll go wrap myself in this dirty flesh and then take on all the penalties of sin and death for the whole world, for all the people to come. Listen to this, church, a key statement as it relates to God gave us deliverance. Not only did Jesus rescue us from hell after we die, Jesus also rescued us from hell on earth. See, too many of us are experiencing hell on earth. You know who's experiencing hell on earth? The person who's confused as to which way they're going. See, we have people in this church who know they're going to heaven, but they're acting like they're going to hell. And you're confused because you don't know which way to go. Your spirit man, who's been reconciled unto the Father by Jesus Christ the righteous, knows he's going up or she's going up, but our flesh is reminding us that we're going down. And we're just stagnant. We're just standing here all day. Yes, Jesus has rescued us after death, but he's rescued us from hell here on earth. And too many of us are experiencing hell on earth. Here's your point three, church. God gave us direction. God gave us dominion. He gave us deliverance. And church, God gave us direction. The direction I'm talking about is an internal GPS system called the Holy Spirit. That internal GPS system that never goes wrong. Because I don't care how, I love Waze. I love me some Waze. But every once in a while, Waze gets it wrong. And, you know, I'm a D.C. boy, and I know every street. My wife is always amazed about how I can get through the city. I'm thinking, in Waze, like, go this way. No, we can't go that way. It's horrible going that way. So Waze doesn't always know the way. I'll get to that in a minute. Let's go to John chapter 14. And mother, it's hard when you get to John chapter 14 not to read from the beginning. You got to start at the beginning. I was going to go straight to, you know, verse 18 or whatever, but you got to start at verse 1. Now, this is Jesus at the end or nearing his earthly ministry, and he's talking to the disciples. And he says here in chapter 14, verse 1, "Let not your heart be troubled. Ye believe in God, believe also in me." I love this. "In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you." Keep in mind, he went to go prepare a place for us. There's some mansions in heaven, but we might just get a place. Be happy with the place. Don't worry about the mansion. I know people who put on robes love to talk about the mansions. We might have a mansion, but I'm okay with the place. Verse 3, "And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye may be also. And whither I go, ye know, and the way you know. My man Thomas saith unto him, Lord, we know not whether thou goest, and how can we know the way? And Jesus said unto him, I am the way and the ways, the truth and the life. No man cometh to the Father but by me. If ye had known me, ye should have known my Father also. And from henceforth ye know him, and have seen him." Drop down to verse 11. "Believe me that I am in the Father, and the Father in me, or else believe me for the very work's sake. Verily, verily, I say unto you, he that believeth on me, the works that I do, shall he do also." I love this verse of scripture. And greater works than these shall he do, because I go unto the Father. He's telling the disciples, yeah, I've done some good work, but y'all going to do greater works than me. Jesus, who's 100% human, 100% divine, told some imperfect, sinning people, because no one was saved yet, because they hadn't given their lives to Christ yet, hadn't been filled with the Spirit yet, said, you're going to do greater works because I'm going to leave you. There's a lot there. Verily, verily, I say unto you, he that believeth on me, the works that he shall do, he also, but greater works than these shall he do, because I go to my Father. Verse 13. And whatsoever ye shall ask in my name, that will I do. See, if you have to ask in Jesus' name, not just putting Jesus' name at the end of the prayer. You have to be in Jesus, and what you pray, he will do. But you can't say, I want a car in Jesus' name. I want a spouse in Jesus' name. Verse 14. If ye shall ask anything in my name, I will do it. If you love me, keep my commandments. And, I love that. If you love me, keep my commandments, and I will pray the Father, and he shall give you another comforter. I'm one comforter, but another one's coming, that he may abide with you forever, even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it seeth him not, neither knoweth him. But ye know him, for he dwelleth where? With you, and shall be where? In you. He says here, disciples, I will not leave you comfortless. I will come to you. Let me be clear. That internal direction that God gave us, here's what it's not. I said it's the Holy Spirit, right? But too many of us are saying other things. It's not something told me. You know how you do something? You go, something told me not to do that. No, someone told you. Here's what it's not. It's not a gut feeling. You know, in my gut, I knew I shouldn't have done that. Nah, that's that river of living water in your belly flowing there. And how about this, life givers? It's not intuition. See, it's going to sting. Life givers, you do not have a monopoly on intuition. Because if you did, you would choose better men. Life givers, you do not have a monopoly on intuition, because if you did, you would choose better men. I'll tease my wife, you know, because I was so fine and good looking. And all this chocolate, she wanted to taste this. And I was as unsaved as anybody could be. But because, you know, I mean, just, come on. She couldn't help herself. But she had no business marrying me. No business. Now, we know that God, by his Spirit, wanted us to be married in 1990. That was already planned out. That was even before our mothers and fathers knew each other. But he was desperately trying to get me saved. In 1987, in 1990, then we got married, then I finally gave my life to Christ in 1994, today, by the way. But life givers, your intuition is broken. Your GPS system called intuition is broken. Y'all are choosing the wrong men. If your man that you're dating won't come to church with you, he's not worth your time. My men, if you are ashamed to bring that side piece in here with you, what I call Popeyes, you got a side piece, and you can't bring them to church with you, they're not worth your time. We have to listen to the Holy Spirit. See, what's interesting about the Holy Spirit, he has a gentle voice, but a tremendous impact. And see, we want to be told what to do. God doesn't tell us to do anything. He gives us a set of instructions and expects us to follow it. But at no point does God tell us to wake up, tell us to get dressed, get out the bed, do this, drive here. No. He says, set your alarm for whatever time you're going to get up, and I'll wake you up. I know the alarm, you think it's going to wake you up, but no, I'm going to wake you up. And then you go from there. But at no point did God, I don't see anybody here where God put a gun in your head to come here and serve us today. See, church, the internal direction God gave us is the Holy Spirit. Not intuition, not something told me, not our gut feeling, but is the Holy Spirit. Here's what's interesting, because, you know, the play is coming up. Even before we gave our lives to Christ, you know, the Holy Spirit stands on the outside of that boardroom. He's still praying for us. And even though our spirit, who's in the boardroom, can't speak, we know that something's amiss. We can hear the grumbling and the mumbling and all the ability that the spirit can speak. We hear something. We know that something's not right. We just can't hear it with our ears, with our spiritual ears. But when we are in Christ, we have no excuse. I don't know who I was talking to. I talk way too much. I was telling somebody, if you are outside the body of Christ and you're sinning, I have all kinds of mercy for you. I mean, I feel for you. Because I'm thinking, oh, my God, you wouldn't have gone into that nightclub on 8th Street at 12 midnight and shot up three people. You wouldn't have done that. You didn't know better. I have no mercy whatsoever for those of us in the body of Christ who choose to sin. We know better. Like, come on. We are actively saying that we're going to choose another way. And we know the way. We know the truth. We know the life. And we choose to go in the opposite direction. See, church, the Holy Spirit is the teacher and the reminder. I don't know about you, but I'll say, I can't remember something. And I'll go, Holy Spirit, speak to my heart. And he does. And guess what I do? Thank you, Holy Spirit. Like, where was that scripture again? He'll go, 2 Corinthians chapter 8. Oh, thank you, Holy Spirit. See, to my call lines, folks, yes, it's great to have the concordance. Yes, it's great to have the Nelson's Dictionary. But have the Holy Spirit in your heart. He'll remind you where the scriptures are. And sometimes he might just say, Mike, go find it in my word. It's there. See, church, the Holy Spirit is our director. He's our guide. He's our enabler. And he's our helper. He's our director. He's our guide. He's our enabler. And he's our helper. But here's what he's not. He's not a doer. We have to do the work. He'll help us do the work, but he's not going to do the work while we help him. See, that's how we have it. Holy Spirit, you do the work. I'm going to help you help me. No. We're going to start something. He's going to come in and teach us and or remind us what to do. So I have two calls today. The first call is, if you're outside the body of Christ, you are making decisions that are wrecking your life, literally. And you need the director, the guide, the enabler, and the helper called the Holy Spirit to come and live on the inside of you. Okay, well, Pastor, I want that. How do I do that? Confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God raised Jesus from the dead. At that moment, you're saved. So if there happens to be someone here present or even watching by our rebroadcast right now, I want you to go ahead and signal me by raising your hand that I want to give my life to Jesus Christ, no matter how young you are or how old you are. Is there anyone present here who has not given their life to Jesus Christ? Then let's pray for the folk that we have online to invite them into the body. Pray after me. Dear Heavenly Father, I confess with my mouth the Lord Jesus, and I believe in my heart that you, Father, raised Jesus from the dead. Today I'm saved, I'm changed to be unchangeable. Thank you, Father. I praise you, Father. In Jesus' name, amen. Here's a second call. You might have been in the first grade, which in the first grade you were six-year-old. Or you might have been 12. And somebody called you something. Somebody did something to you that has forever changed how you view yourself. And you're not six and you're not 12 anymore. And you're still making every decision based upon what that person said or did to you way back when. Today, I want you to put it in the trash can. And I have it up here at the altar because that's where all the trash belongs, on the altar. So before you leave this service, if you know in your heart that there's some things that aren't right in you as it relates to what people have said or done to you, that's challenged your value, that's challenged your worth, write it on a scrap piece of paper, write it legibly, whatever you want to do, and then throw it away. And what we're going to do is throw this trash where it belongs, in the trash, because what they said to you is trash. It has no value whatsoever. So I want you to think hard. I already had mine. I've already thrown mine away. I've told you all about this, but my skin complexion. I'm over that. I've gone too far on the other side. But search your heart. Let God search your heart. If there's something that you've been battling with, whether it's been from yesteryear or yesterday, that someone said to you or did to you, write it on a piece of paper. And before service is over, throw it away. This is not a cute exercise. I'm not doing this for entertainment. I'm doing this to give. I need to preach to as many different people as possible. And as Mother said, we all learn differently. And if we need a visual aid of a trash can sitting in front of service all this time to let us know that what people think about us is trash, then so be it. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to do things differently. For those who gave their lives to Christ, I want you to, especially for those watching by the live stream, if there's someone who gave their life to Christ sitting in their seat, just let one of the ministers know and we'll bring you in. Because guess what? I don't care if you stand or you sit, if you wave your hands, if you run up here. I just want you in the kingdom. So however you do it, do it. But what I want, though, is to make sure that those who are watching, let us know that you gave your life to Christ. Go over to our homepage, because right now you're watching by our YouTube channel, and make your way over to our homepage at fthcmow.org and click on the I'm New tab. And when you do so, go ahead and click on the give your life to Christ, or how to the plan of salvation. And once you do that, follow the prompts that are there, hit submit, and then someone from this great office will reach out to you and welcome you to the body of Christ. And if by chance you want to join the church, whether you're here present or whether you're here online, and for those who are present, just see us after service and we'll welcome you into the church. And if for those who are online, continue on our homepage. You're already on the I'm New tab, and then click on the How to Join the Church button. And when you do, follow the prompts that are there, and then someone from our restoration ministry will reach out to you and welcome you to your new church home. Amen. What I'm going to do is quietly give the benediction. Today, yes, we can have fellowship and all that, but give people the space and the grace and the no judgment to come up here and throw something away that needs to be thrown away. Amen. I didn't say that you couldn't fellowship, but just be sensitive to the people who might be making their way here. Let us pray for the benediction. You can remain seated. Now unto him, to our heavenly Father, who is able to keep us from falling and failing, and present us faultless before his presence with exceeding great joy, to the only wise God, our Savior and soon coming King, to him be glory, majesty, dominion, and power both for now and forevermore. It's in Jesus Christ's name we do pray and give thanks. Amen. Amen. God bless you. So again, for those who desire, as the Lord leads you by his Spirit, come and throw away whatever you need to have thrown away. Amen. Love you.